ladies and gentlemen, the songs of Neil Sedaka.
Clap your hands for rock and roll, come on. Let's put the music takes me.
Celebrating his 70th birthday in 2009, Neil Sedaka is one of popular music's great survivors. In a career spanning six decades, his smash hits continue to enthrall audiences all over the world.
It's brilliant, this man's a legend. Seriously, he really is.
Beautiful singer, absolutely beautiful singer.
From the minute I heard his music, I rushed out and I bought every Neil Sedaka album I could find.
I can feel my soul exploding. There's a good feeling helping me to find my way.
As a teenager, Sedaka was destined for a career as a classical pianist. But at the age of 13, he was seduced by the raw sounds of rock and roll.
I go wave every time I see you smile.
Who could do a whole set of number one records and then get out there and do Brahms or Mozart or Beethoven? It's beyond belief.
Sedaka made his breakthrough in the late 1950s as a songwriter during the dawn of rock and roll. His songs, from O Carol and Calendar Girl to Laughter in the Rain and Solitaire, have become part of popular music history.
And solitaire's the only game.
Everybody from Elvis Presley to the Carpenters to Tom Jones, everybody has sung Neil Sedaka songs.
What Neil has already done is shown us that some of his songs stand the test of time because they're still being enjoyed today by a whole other generation.
Show me the way to Amarillo. I've been weeping like a willow.
The 2005 comic relief version of Sedaka's song Is This the Way to Amarillo is one of the best-selling UK singles of the 21st century.
He's very lucky, Neil, because apart from being a great songwriter, he's a great singer, you know. So he's got two careers in parallel.
I think we'll be playing Neil Sedaka songs forever. They're of such a quality that they have a timelessness about them. They're just brilliant.
As far as I'm concerned, he's a genius. There's no other word for him.
Brooklyn, New York. On the 13th of March, 1939, Neil Sedaka was born to a working-class Jewish family. His parents, Mac and Eleanor, lived on Coney Island Avenue with Neil's sister Ronnie, his grandparents, and five aunts.
We were 11 people in a two-bedroom apartment, so I was quite spoiled and babied, being the only little boy. My mother said I wouldn't eat until there was music on the radio. We had an old phonograph player, and she went out and bought a 78 record. I'll never forget it. It was by the Moylan sisters, and she saw my reaction. And I remember running with the 78 to the record player, slipped, cracked it into a million pieces, and being the Jewish mother that she was, she ran back to King's Highway and bought another copy of the 78.
Brighton Beach, Brooklyn, in the 1940s, was a Jewish neighborhood where lower to middle class families like the Sedakas promoted the values of education and culture to their children.
I had a neighbor who had a piano, and when I was 8 years old, I noticed that I could pick out a tune with one finger by ear. Of course, we couldn't afford a piano, but my mother took a job as a sales lady in a department store. We bought a secondhand piano for $500, and I started playing with a private teacher, Murray Newman. And after a year, he came to my mother and father and said, I can't teach him anymore. I think he should audition for the Juilliard School, the prep school. And I got a scholarship for the piano.
Once a week from 1947 until 1958, Neil traveled to Manhattan with fellow pianist and best friend Freddie Gershon. Entering Juilliard was a culture shock for the eight-year-old boys.
We were exposed to a world of serious music. There's no frivolity there. It's not just learning how to play the instrument. It's learning musicianship and the difference between being a piano player or pianist. There was conducting classes, ear training classes.
It was a very rigid life. The Juilliard people knew nothing but serious music. And one Saturday each month, we would have to perform in front of the teachers and the students, and I used to throw up.
But although Neil suffered from stage fright, his skills as a pianist stood out even at Juilliard. And as a teenager, he won a competition to perform at the WQXR radio station.
Neil Sedaka is going to play for us the Reflet dans l'eau of Debussy.
His ability to grasp musical concepts and ideas and approaches to his instrument was a gift. Juilliard was a defining element of our lives in terms of opening our eyes to see the world, the adventure of discovering that Manhattan is like going to the Emerald City in The Wizard of Oz. That's how far removed it was from Brooklyn where we lived. So we had this great time. We went to Radio City Music Hall, we saw the live stage shows, we got to see Broadway shows, and we devoured it.
However, Neil's classical training didn't endear him to all the kids in high school.
Lincoln High School was tough. I was an outcast because I couldn't play ball, and I was a sensitive kid with a high voice. I was a nerd.
By the time he was 13, Neil seemed destined for life as a concert pianist.
But then I was sidetracked thanks to Howie Greenfield, who lived in the same apartment building in Brooklyn. He knocked at my door, 1952, October the 11th, I remember it exactly. And I said, "What do you want?" He said, "Well, my mother said you play the piano and I can write lyrics. Would you like to write a song?" I said, "I don't know how to write songs. I'm going to be a concert pianist." And I'm so glad he convinced me.
My life's devotion is loving you only.
The songs were not good at the beginning, you know. I remember my sister laughing in the kitchen. She said, "Oh, that's awful." And they were. But, you know, the more you do it, the better you become.
I only live for you.
The pair worked hard on writing new material. And soon Neil was brave enough to sing their songs in public.
I played a song called Mr. Moon at a high school talent show. And it was the first time that I was popular in school. So it was a way of being accepted.
Sedaka's early songs were in the style of Rodgers and Hart and George Gershwin. But when he heard Earth Angel by doo-wop group The Penguins, his musical outlook was turned upside down.
Earth Angel, Earth Angel, will you be mine?
It was teenage music, it was raw, it was exciting, it was spontaneous.
In the mid-50s, doo-wop bands such as the Penguins, the Platters, and the Teenagers were forming all over America. Neil was inspired to write in the new doo-wop style, and in 1955, he formed his own group, the Linktones, who later achieved world fame as the Tokens.
We were singing songs that he wrote that were original tunes. That was like an unheard of thing for a bunch of kids to do this.
And we would sing in various weddings, bar mitzvahs, record hops.
The musical changes were not the normal four chord changes as most of the R&B records were. They were a little more sophisticated. Neil was very much into melody and harmony. And Neil would teach us all our parts separately, and then we would all sing it together with Neil, and then you had that beautiful blend of the harmony. It was one of the greatest times of my life to be part of that thing with Neil.
In 1956, the Tokens were invited by Melba Records to record some of their songs.
I love my baby, da, 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 maybe, da, 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 da.
I remember I wanted it with a vengeance. I looked at the microphone and I said, "This is it." My first time in front of a microphone in a studio. And I liked hearing my own song taking shape. And I said, "I think this is for me."
I Love My Baby reached number 32 on the New York charts. A year later, Neil parted company with the Tokens to pursue his songwriting ambitions.
You're like a king.
Howie and I were writing and peddling to many publishing firms. Atlantic Records, they would take many of our songs and record it with their black artists. So I had a couple of R&B hits, Clyde McFadda, Since You've Been Gone, Laverne Baker, I Waited Too Long.
I waited too long, and now we're apart.
Having enjoyed some success as a songwriter and performer, Neil was desperate to get a publishing contract. But in 1956, the history of popular music changed forever.
Walking through a party in the county jail, the prison band was there, they began to wail.
When Elvis Presley burst onto the national scene, the Brill Building in New York was home to America's lucrative music publishing industry. But with the birth of rock and roll, there was a rush to cash in on the craze, and a new breed of publishing firms opened on 1650 Broadway, including Alden Music, owned by the pioneering team of Al Nevins and Don Kirshner.
We had an office about the size of a closet, with a little piano in the middle and two desks, and I was sweeping up the floors, and the doorbell rings, and it was Neil Sedaka and Howard Greenfield. So I said, you know, let me see what you got.
We played four or five songs, and they said, these are good.
So I said, I know this girl called Connie Francis. She's got a big record called Who's Sorry Now, and maybe we can get the follow-up record. So they had nothing to lose, and I said, if I get you a song on the charts, will you sign with me for 5 years?
And he called me up and he said, I have two young kids. I said, please, Donnie, everybody says they have two genius kids. No, these are great. When can you meet them?
We went to Connie's home and Neil started playing, I think, some ballads. I asked him to play a rhythm song.
Neil and Howie played songs into the night. Beautiful songs, but nothing really hit me. And I got so bored that I threw myself on my sofa. I started writing in my diary.
She was very disinterested, and I said to Howie, we're losing her. I think I'm going to stray away from the ballads, and I'm going to do Stupid Cupid.
I started jumping up and down and said, now you got it, fellas. You guys got my next record, Stupid Cupid. Hit title, what a smash. And that was their first record.
He's Stupid Cupid, you're a real mean guy. I'd like to clip your wings so you can't fly. 'Cause I'm in love and it's a crying shame. And I know the total boy to blame. Hey, hey, set me free. Hey, Stupid Cupid, stop picking on me. You got me jumping like a crazy clown. And I don't feature what you're putting down.
I was so thrilled to hear one of my songs over and over on my transistor radio. And then I would buy Billboard magazine, my Bible, and see the hits, and lo and behold, I think went to number 14. It was an absolute dream come true.
In 1958, Stupid Cupid became an international hit, reaching number one in the UK, and Sedaka and Greenfield were on their way. Still only 18 and recently graduated from Lincoln High School, his mother insisted he enter Juilliard full-time. Neil was invited to play at the world-famous Tchaikovsky piano competition in Moscow. But chart success led to that invitation being withdrawn.
My name was linked with capitalistic American rock and roll, and that was a no-no in Russia. So I was upset, but I was a bit relieved because playing classical music was always a chore for me.
It was the tipping point in Neil's life. He left Juilliard and threw all his energies into his rock and roll career. Sedaka formed a band, the Northern Elves, and in the summer of 1958, they went to the Esther Manor Hotel, northwest of New York, to look for work.
Norman Spears, the trumpet player, said, oh, let's go because we can meet girls and we can have sex easily there. So I said, I'm good for that. Let's go. So we went into the Esther Manor Hotel and I saw this girl behind the desk and she was the owner's daughter, Liba.
And my mother, who's standing outside when the car pulled in, said, oh, all the waiter and busboy jobs are filled. And Neil proudly said, oh no, we're the band.
She said, I'm calling the agent. I will not have children playing for my guests. So we begged her. We said, oh, Esther, please give us the weekend.
And he came up to me and said, hello, my name is Neil Sedaka, and I write songs. That was the most ludicrous thing I ever heard.
Stupid Cupid, you're a real mean guy.
And then I heard Connie Francis singing Stupid Cupid, and I said, well, he couldn't make that up. I guess, as you say, the rest is history.
Stupid Cupid.
By the end of the summer, Neil and Lieber were an item. And following the success of Stupid Cupid, Alden Music offered Sedaka and Greenfield a songwriting contract, where Neil was also keen to develop his singing career.
I thought that rather than give my songs away, I wanted to try singing them myself.
The best purveyor is the writer of their own songs if they could sing. And I felt Neil could be an important artist.
Johnny Kirshner and Al Nevins knew Steve Scholes, the producer of Elvis, RCA Victor Records. And I auditioned with the Diary.
How I'd like to look into that little book, the one that has the lock and key.
And someone says, you know, it really sounds great. If we throw in some strings or something, we could probably release that in its current incarnation with that girl singing. They said, no, that's not a girl, that's a guy. He's just singing very high. Okay, whatever.
The Diary sold 600,000 records to the shock and amazement of Ronnie, my sister, who told me, you'll never make it. There are thousands of people who can sing and write.
I look for uniqueness. If you hear Elvis Presley, you know it's his voice. And Neil's voice with the high sound, to me, had a sound that you immediately identified with.
Do you recall and make note of all?
In 1958, The Diary reached number 14 on the Billboard charts, but Neil's next two singles flopped. Like so many artists of the late 50s, Sedaka was in danger of becoming a one-hit wonder, and RCA threatened to terminate his recording contract.
And they said, we'll give you one more shot. And I looked at the Billboard Hits of the World, and I bought the number one record in every country in the world and saw what they had in common. And it was mostly a girl's name in those days, a certain guitar lick, a drum break, harmonic rhythm. And there was a piece I was studying by Villa-Lobos, the Doll family, and it went... So I went, darling, there will never be another. The pattern. Cause I love you so.
Don't ever leave me.
I dated Carol. I dated her for 2 minutes back in high school days.
The Carol in question was none other than Carole King, one of the finest singer-songwriters of her generation. The song reached the U.S. top 10 and was a massive worldwide hit.
People actually learned English in various countries around the world by listening to O'Carroll because it was so simple.
Darling, there will never be another, 'cause I love you so. Don't ever leave me, say you'll never go. I will always want you for my sweetheart.
I remember getting a royalty check, and I ran upstairs, and I said to my father, oh, look, $2,600. He said, Neil, you read it wrong. It's $26,000.
Neil's life was transformed. It was the Emerald City, and it was the good fairy came down, hit him with the magic wand, and he had a convertible Chevrolet. He became a big deal.
Teenagers all over the world went wild over O'Carroll, and Neil recorded the song in several languages, including Hebrew and Spanish. And in 1959, Sedaka was invited to perform in South America.
When I landed, I saw hundreds of people in the airport, And I said to my mother, there must be someone very famous on this plane. Crowds pushing, screaming. I had no idea.
It was the same story in the Far East and Europe. But the constant traveling put a huge strain on Neil's relationship with his girlfriend, Lieber.
And that's when he said, I really think we should be going out with other people.
I said, oh, I have a hit record. This is an opportunity of a lifetime. I'm 19 years old. I'm known all over the world. I think we should hold up the engagement and the marriage. And she said, well, then let's call it off.
Well, my life was over. My life was over.
Putting his private life on hold, Sedaka concentrated on writing simple, innocent songs. And in the early 1960s, he recorded a string of teenage smash hits.
Neil and Howie, they wrote these great records, you know. So danceable, and the lyric was so great that Howie wrote, and the hooks that Neil wrote, and his choruses were so... You said, you know, they had to be hits. Because you could just hear it once, and you just sing along with it.
Neil brought this extra sort of dimension of happiness, joy, exuberance, humor, you know, they were very jolly.
All of his records were that way, you know, and especially the early ones, like Happy Birthday, Sweet 16.
Happy Birthday, Sweet 16. What happened to that funny face? My little tomboy now wears satins and lace.
The Howie Greenfield, Neil Sedaka songs were wholesome, not evasive, not elusive. We were obsessed with ethereal stairways, heavens and devils. The fans were kids.
Willa, 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 heavenly angel, I want you for my girl.
He wrote exactly for who we were. And, you know, we were looking for girls, we were looking for cars, were we gonna go to the prom, were we gonna have the date? You know, he sold a lot of records in those days.
Store, I'll build a stairway to heaven, 'cause heaven is where you are.
Sedaka was a teen idol because of his great songs, his melodies, he would touch a nerve. Calendar Girl was the type of thing that he was talking to every young girl or even guy in America and fulfilling their dreams. He did a, we didn't even know it was called a music video then, but he did a Calendar Girl video. And it was fabulous. He had a group of girls behind him and he was playing piano and dancing with them.
Neil's image was that of a clean-cut teen idol. Behind the scenes, he still lived at home with his parents in Brooklyn and was managed by his mother. But Sedaka's life changed in 1961 when he got back in touch with his teenage sweetheart.
I'm living right next door to an angel.
Lieber had a lovely nose, but it was a Barbra Streisand nose. And she thought that was the reason that I turned her down. So she went ahead and had cosmetic surgery done on her nose. She was always beautiful, but it gave her confidence. Her whole demeanor was different. And we started dating again.
And then he called one night and he said, no, enough of this. I think we should get engaged. I think we should get married. He came up the next week with a ring.
On September the 11th, 1962, Neil and Lieber tied the knot. But the marriage didn't go down well with Sedaka's record company.
Teen idols did not get married. It would be bad for the fans. Our wedding and our marriage was to be a secret.
Whoa, 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 yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey, little devil.
Even after the wedding, Neil's mother Eleanor still wanted to maintain control over all aspects of his life.
I was a mama's boy. Whatever my mother said, I did.
Hey, little devil.
we were on an allowance, and she found us the apartment, which was across the street from her home. And I said, oh, Neil and I were thinking of moving to Manhattan. She said, if you move to Manhattan, I'll cut you off. You won't get any money. Hello?
To complicate matters, Neil's mother was having an affair with Ben Suter.
I said to Dad, no. She said, yes, I wouldn't do it without Dad's approval. And yes, my father gave his approval. Because my father was a lovely guy, but he was very cheap. And he said, I think it's wonderful that this gentleman would take you out to dinner, take you on trips. I can't do that. And my mother's friend became my manager. He was actually an air conditioning salesman, knew nothing about the business. And we were put on a salary of $250 a week. And my mother was going around the world wearing diamonds. And little did I know that I was paying for everything.
By 1962, Sedaka had enjoyed 8 US Top 40 hits, but he and Howie Greenfield were still searching for the song that would take Neil to the top of the charts.
Howie was very, very slow. He used to agonize over every word, like Marcel Proust. And often when they came to do the demo, Howie would not have finished the lyric. And so Neil would play the song, the unfinished song, and fill in the words with a doobie-doo and sha-la-la and that kind of thing.
They became a trademark of mine. I was the king of the doobie-doos. Down, doobie-doo, down, down.
Breaking up is hard to do. Don't take your love away from me.
He could hear, as Howie was writing, how he wanted the vocals to be and how he wanted the doobie doobies to be behind it. Well, that's a gift that most composers of the period never had.
He was the ultimate songwriter. He would effectively arrange the songs. He helped with the production. The innovation of double tracking a lot, which was Neil double tracking himself.
The first track I would do, the background, do-do-do, down, do-be-do, down, down. Second take, second track I would do, don't take your love away from me. And the last track, the high melody, don't take your love away from me. And I saved the melody for the last, because each generation would lose level.
Don't you leave my heart in misery.
We would have a group who eventually turned out to be the Cookies, and they would do counters that really got under your skin.
They say that breaking up is hard to do. Now I know that it's true. Don't say this is the end.
Breaking up is hard to do. It was really the romantic anthem, the feeling of every guy and girl in America. And he was really their poet and their spokesperson.
Can we give our love another try?
Great songs are the ones that stand the test of time. So what Neil has already done is shown us that some of his songs stand the test of time, because, I mean, Breaking Up is Hard to Do is, to me, one of the best songs still, ever.
In August 1962, Neil achieved his dream of a number one hit as Breaking Up reached the top of the U.S. charts.
It was an unbelievable time, and Neil and Howie became, you know, the hottest writers in the city.
I had sold about 20 million records worldwide, and I had 10 hits in a row. And then your Beatles and Rolling Stones came in, changed the whole business.
There was no world left. There was a revolution.
Nobody wanted anything but British bands. And American bands and American singers had to put on British accents to sound like British people. It sounded like Liverpudlians, you know. And someone like Neil, who came from Brooklyn and was totally American, and all his references and his sound, just was completely wiped out overnight.
So I went from being a star to people stopping me. Didn't you used to be Neil Sedaka? The record stopped playing.
For many artists of Neil's generation, the the British invasion signaled the end of the road. As his performing career came to an abrupt end, he was forced to concentrate on his songwriting. Sedaka and Greenfield signed a new contract with Alden Music, where Don Kirshner was bringing together some of the finest songwriting teams of the era.
And it was amazing. In one room, Bobby Darin would be playing Dream Lover.
A dream lover will come my way.
Man of Wild would be writing for me, You Lost That Lovin' Feeling. Tony Wine and Carol Bersega would be playing A Groovy Kind of Love, which the Mindbenders did. It was such an amazing period, and it was a hit factory of music.
Working at Alden Music allowed Neil to collaborate with new talent, including lyricist Carol Bayer.
I saw Neil once, and I said, well, do you think you'd write a song with me ever? And he said, yes, I will, you know. And so that was the beginning of a very long friendship. We did get very lucky because we wrote a song called When Love Comes Knocking at Your Door.
When love comes knocking at your door, just open up and let it in.
We ended up having it recorded by the Monkees. It was just sweet. It was kind of like Neil-ish.
We were lucky enough to get a couple of songs in one of their albums that sold 3 million copies. So that paid the rent for a while.
Over the next few years, Neil enjoyed success writing songs for other artists, such as The Fifth Dimension and Tom Jones.
Baby, baby, you know it's true. I'm a puppet just for you.
Artists from all over the world were on the lookout for his songs, including the management of young British singer Tony Christie.
Neil sat down at the piano and he started doing it and started singing Amarillo. But the minute they heard this song, they just said, we've got to get in the studio quickly and get this recorded before anybody else gets hold of it. And I think within a week, we went in the studios and we made the song.
Is this the way to Amarillo? Every night I've been hugging my pillow, dreaming dreams of Amarillo, and sweet Marie who waits for me.
We knew it was going to be a hit. It just took off, and nothing could stop that song.
Royalties were flowing in, but being out of the limelight himself was a bitter pill for Neil to swallow.
As much as I was happy, it wasn't me on the stage singing my own songs. It's quite different. Once you get a taste of being number one and getting those standing ovations, you never lose that. And it was a lot to swallow. It was a lot to swallow.
Working normal office hours as a songwriter, Neil enjoyed spending time at home with his young family.
When I was born in 1966, I think he hadn't had a hit in about 3 years. So it was certainly to my advantage that I had a father pretty much full time.
He was always a great father. He attempted to teach me the piano when I was quite young, and it did not work. So my mother said, maybe if you're somebody else, change your identity. So he put on this raincoat and a hat, and he called himself Dr. Bergunka, the piano teacher. I was equally as disinterested then as when he was my dad. It didn't fly.
The mid to late 60s were Sedaka's so-called hungry years. His days as a performer were a distant memory, and big changes were called for. But in 1968, ambitious new agent Dick Fox approached Neil with an eye to rescuing his singing career.
He felt he was gone. Basically a has-been, but I didn't think that way. I said, a talent like that can never stay gone or stay away forever. I just think you have to reinvent yourself, which is what he did.
Up until now, Sedaka was still managed by Ben Suter, his mother's boyfriend, and Neil felt he had no choice but to sack him.
She tried to do away with herself by taking an overdose of sleeping pills. Because here, the two people she loved most in the world, her son and her lover, were at odds, and we fought. And it was a terrible time, but we made up. We were very close.
And at that point, we turned it into a mom-pa business. I'm ma. And I took over the management, which wasn't all that much to take over because there wasn't all that much happening.
I got
The early 70s was the era of the singer-songwriter, and the time was ripe for a comeback. Armed with a new collection of songs, Neil was also keen to return to the studio.
It was much easier to break an artist that no one had ever heard of than to break Neil Sedaka, because you had to undo what he was and then build upon that. And that was real difficult because they had this preconceived idea of who they thought he was, and they wouldn't let him out of that mold. And if there was anybody that was a great singer-songwriter, it was Sedaka.
I'm a song and I've waited so long for someone to come and sing me.
He'd always been a singer-songwriter before they had the phrase singer-songwriter. It was the time for him to come back with an album called Emergence, which had wonderful songs on it.
There's a certain hunger on those songs and a yearning on those songs that make them magical.
But the record company just would not promote that album. It's a brilliant album. Even then, when the climate was right, it wasn't easy for him.
Where's the world you used to know? Where did all the good times go?
Sedaka's comeback album was critically acclaimed, but Howard Greenfield's lyrics were thought to be old-fashioned.
But like a fool, you still keep hanging on.
Howie and I had an agreeable parting of the ways, and it's very hard when you've been writing with somebody for so many years to split. It's like a marriage. So it was a very emotional kind of parting.
This will be our last song together. Words will only make us cry.
Neil and Howie went out with a bang. Love Will Keep Us Together and Our Last Song proved to be some of their most enduring material. But in his quest to re-establish himself as a performer, Sedaka knew he needed a new lyricist.
He just knocked on the door. I looked at him, I said, who is this dude? You know, because I had long hair, I was a hippie, and here was this guy that looked like he just walked off the tennis court. So this was another planet visiting, worlds colliding. He said that he wanted to write, and I just sort of said, well, this is perverse, I think I can go for that.
Stumbling along, someone somewhere's been neglecting things.
Cody and Sedaka wrote a new collection of songs, but after the lack of chart success for Emergence, getting a recording deal proved difficult.
He had written some great, great songs, but nobody wanted them. They kept pigeonholing him into the bubblegum pop rock and roll, and that's when I had suggested that he go over to England.
During 1971, Neil took the bravest decision of his life by moving his family to the UK. On this side of the Atlantic, he retained a strong fan base since playing here in the early 60s, and Neil threw everything into resurrecting his career.
I had to swallow my pride. I had to do the Wookiee Hollow in Liverpool, the Golden Garter in Manchester, working men's clubs. And I would have to do two shows a night, and they would talk through the new songs.
However, the decision to tour the UK soon paid dividends when he teamed up with emerging musicians and producers 10cc at the legendary Strawberry Studios in Stockport during 1972.
That's when the music takes me to a brighter day.
Neil was going to come over to do some gigs at Batley Variety Club, which is near Leeds in the north of England. And the idea was that he'd maybe just record a few tracks with us.
And I wound up doing two albums, The Trella Days Are Over and The Solitaire album.
It kick-started his career again. I mean, he had his history, which was wonderful, but a lot of people discovered him as a new artist.
And solitaire's the only game in town. Every road that takes him down. While life goes on around him everywhere, he's playing solitaire.
Solitaire was the first thing out of the box for us. He played this incredibly sad melody. And I sort of got coerced into exploring my loneliness.
Another losing game comes to an end. Deals them out again.
It was written as a lonely man who plays the game of solitaire. And even though He is depressed and down and out. He gets up the next morning and starts again and goes on with life.
It was sort of like the old Michelangelo thing, that the statue is in the stone. And it was all there in what Neil was doing. I just had to find the right words to fit the emotions that he was playing.
There was a man.
When we recorded it, he was crying. And he said, my God, he said, did I write that? And we said, yes, he bloody well did. Yes, it's amazing.
And solitaire's the only game in town. And every road that takes him down. While life goes on around him,
two albums recorded with 10cc at Strawberry Studios put Sedaka back in the limelight in the UK. He never released Solitaire as a single, but the song was later covered by artists ranging from the Carpenters to Andy Williams and Elvis Presley. The Sedaka family settled in a penthouse flat in Mayfair, and he was treated as rock and roll royalty.
I went to a Bee Gees concert in London, and I met Elton John backstage. He said, I heard that you're recording new songs with the 10cc's. May I come to your flat to hear them?
Standing on the outside, looking in.
Neil was unaware of Elton's influence as a musician and sought advice from old friend Freddie Gershon.
And I said, he is the most happening thing in America. Just make sure he knows you have an album, you own the master, it's out on Polygram UK, but no one has released it in America.
It's time that you broke through.
He said, I'm starting a record company. Would you like to join the label? And I said, you must be kidding. Would I like to join your Rocket Records? I said, absolutely. And we had a party that night, and he said, it was like someone handing me gold bricks. Solitaire, that's when the music takes me, laughter in the rain.
After the success of the two British LPs, Rocket Records were keen to break Sedaka in America, and Elton John invited Neil to record new material in Los Angeles.
He went with an absolute do or die, I've got the material and I can do this. And as he started to record, the word spread and it became the talk of the town.
Elton said, what do you want to call it? I said, Sedaka's back.
Elton was very important for finally cracking the American charts for a second time.
He went on radio stations in the United States. And he called himself EJ the DJ. And he would play Laughter in the Rain.
Strolling along country roads with my baby. It starts to rain, it begins to pour.
He just needed somebody to give him the validity. And if Elton John said he's great, that means he had to be great. Then it was off to the races.
Neil became contemporary, rediscovered by a new audience. And ultimately, meeting Elton changed his life forever.
Ooh, I hear laughter in the rain, walking hand in hand with the one I love. Ooh, I love the rainy days and the happy way I feel inside.
After 10 years in the wilderness, Neil's single, Laughter in the Rain, was climbing the US charts when he was invited to top the bill at the Troubadour Club in Hollywood in 1975.
Opening night, I'm gonna cry. Opening night, we were listening to the radio because they played the top 10.
And now the number one. the number one record in the country, Laughter in the Rain by Neil Sedaka. Libra and I danced and cried to it. I'll never forget that moment.
That was a pivotal moment, and Sedaka was truly back.
Laughter in the Rain was 1975 in microcosm. It represented a total shift away from the old Neil Sedaka to the new stuff that he wanted to do.
Neil came back with much more complex, much more sort of emotionally sort of, you know, probing songs like The Immigrant.
Harbors open their arms to the young searching foreigner. Come to live in the light of the beacon of liberty.
The Immigrant was inspired by John Lennon's clashes with the Nixon government over his green card. Lennon's opposition to the Vietnam War led the authorities to take a hard line against him.
Was it anything like that when you arrived? Dreamboats carried the future to the heart of America.
The Immigrant is a very powerful protest against this ethos in a country where Neil says there was a time when strangers were welcome here.
Musically, I think Neil was able to soften The Immigrant for listeners, you know, the people who had expectations of him. And it was our one successful foray into social commentary. And at the time, social commentary was a very important aspect of the music world.
Following his long-awaited breakthrough back in America, Sedaka returned to the studio to record his second album for Rocket Records, The Hungry Years. And Elton John popped in to appear as guest vocalist.
He was very gracious. He said, I would like to do a duet on one of the songs. And he listened to three songs. One was called Bad Blood. He said, that's the one. I want to do Bad Blood.
Bad blood. The woman was born to lie.
I have no idea where it came from other than my old Sicilian grandmother's superstition. She would always say, that one's got bad blood, you be careful for him. Yeah, and that got into a song, and it did great.
Tomorrow stand, looks mighty strange. How you let a woman like that treat you like small change? I don't understand what you're looking to find. Mess up a good man's mind. Hear me talking to your bad blood. He's taking you for a ride.
Bad Blood went to number one in like an hour. I mean, it was one of those records that you just came out and it was amazing.
The single was awarded a gold disc in 1975 and remains the most successful U.S. hit of Neil's career. The reemergence of Sedaka as a force in the mid-70s inspired a new generation of artists to cover his songs.
A&M Records sent me a 45 of an unknown group called the Captain and Tennille singing my song, Love Will Keep Us Together. And I almost fell off my chair when I listened to it.
Generally, when you hear a song, you listen to it, like that, I like that, I don't like that part. But then there are certain songs that happen that, yes, that's it, you know. And Love Will Keep Us Together was one of those, just came right out, and that was such a monster record, and you knew it was gonna be.
Look in my heart and let love keep us together.
It was very 70s, and I remember doing a dance routine in my summer camp to Love Will Keep Us Together, and it was a big, big hit.
Love Will Keep Us Together earned Sedaka the Grammy for Song of the Year in 1975. The family moved back from London to New York, and with his newfound success, Neil became a much-loved personality on stage and screen.
He's one of the great performers. He loves to perform. You can see it on his face. It's just in his body.
He loves the love that he gets from the audience. And they love not only his music, but they sense the love that he is sending to them.
I'm gonna march you down the aisle, 'cause you're the Easter Bunny when you smile.
The first time around, I was just a voice really on the radio. The second time, I then became a personality. It was a more rewarding, more secure career.
In 1977, Sedaka signed a deal with Elektra Records and returned to the charts in 1980 with Should Have Never Let You Go, a duet with daughter Dara.
When you look into my eyes, I find it hard to find the words to say.
I liked it from first hearing it, so I would sing it alone, and Dad had a party in Manhattan.
And I asked Dara to sing along with me at the piano.
And that kind of started the ball rolling in turn. And he said, well, let's record it. And then he said, I really think that this stands a good shot if we put it out as a single. And we toured extensively in the States.
I should have never let you go.
During the 80s and early 90s, Sedaka maintained his high profile and popularity. For the first time, Neil's new songs featured his own lyrics, and the albums were always eagerly anticipated all over the world.
You can find the rest of Neil Sedaka on his brand new album, Timeless, but here he is with Miracle Song.
All my life, I've been a kind of lonely man.
There's been an evolution. He just likes to experiment with different styles.
For my way.
He's constantly reinventing himself. A few years ago, he said, what should I do next? And I said, well, what can you do that nobody else can do? And he said, I'm going to put lyrics to classical music. And that's how Classically Sedaka came about.
I hide from the sun in my lonely room. I cry myself to sleep, dreaming of you.
In 2003, Neil celebrated 50 years as a songwriter, and his music found a new generation of fans when he appeared as a guest judge on American Idol.
The singers were great, Kimberly Locke and Ruben Studded, but Clay Aiken did Solitaire and stopped the show.
And keeping to himself, he plays the game. Without her love,
bravo, Clay. I have lost my song forever to you. It will always be a Clay Aiken song.
Thank you.
I have to congratulate you, Neil, on that song, because that is a 10, that song. I mean, it's just superb.
American Idol brought him a whole new audience of teenagers. When we went to a finale the year later, these kids were running up to him and so thrilled to see him.
I think American Idol is great for showing how artists of the past can still be relevant. And I think you can always take his songs and reinvent them in some way and make them relevant again.
You slept all night.
I did a kiddie album recently, changing the words, poking fun at myself, waking up is hard to do, or where the toys are, or lunch will keep us together. And my six-year-old granddaughters are singing the background.
Songs, and I like how he plays the piano.
January!
We went to the studio and we sang some songs. First, one of us goes, then the other.
I had to have cookies and candy to give them a sugar high, to keep them in front of the microphone.
If you did it, you would get it. So we were like, okay, so we just did it. And then we just got the candy.
I've always felt the childlike aspect of my father has been key to his success, and through the years that he's brought to me and now to my children, that there's just always a childlike sense of wonder and excitement and exuberance with his music and everything that he does.
Neil's greatest joy is being with his grandchildren, unquestionably. And I think the second greatest joy is walking out on the stage and feeling the validation.
In his 70th year, Neil Sedaka continues to tour all over the world. During the summer of 2009, he played to packed houses all over the UK, featuring songs from his new album, The Music of My Life.
The songs are some of the best I've written in 57 years of writing. They really come from my soul.
And if the song should ever end, my heart will never be the same. The song will always speak your name. You are the music of my life. The song will always speak your name. You are the music of my life.
I think live performance has kept me young. There's a natural adrenaline rush. If I write a new song, you get an immediate response. Records, you don't. Television, you don't.
There is a drive, and I think the drive has not diminished. He really, truly enjoys the craft of being on stage and performing, and he loves the audience reaction. And there's an addictive quality to it.
When the day is dawning on a Texas Sunday morning.
I think my father has been retiring for at least the last 30 years. I remember as a kid him saying, this is the last year, this is it, I'm stopping now.
He's not a kid anymore, but yet, he's a kid when he's up there. And the audience believes it, and they feel it, and they follow him. And he's got a tremendous following.
Is this the way to battle?
His songs are really catchy. The tunes are always getting people up dancing.
Great songwriter, great performer, great pianist.
He's been going so many years and he just hasn't changed. He gets better and better, in fact. He's just brilliant.
He can't stop being prolific. I mean, that's just the nature of his being. I don't know when he'll stop. I don't know if he'll stop.
A creative person always tries to prove themselves, to improve, to develop and grow. You're never satisfied. You have to keep doing something that excites you, something fresh and new. That's what we all strive for.
If I can take these precious moments, put them in a box, if I can feel these times once more, I'd turn back the clock. Wouldn't it be wonderful the way that things were there? I would like to turn back.